Alrighty then, we're talking with Dr. Greg Chernoff, plastic surgeon, and he gave a wonderful, I think almost 90-minute lecture about your use of exosomes.
Yes.
So you are triple boarded, and you have been involved with the aesthetic side, but tell me, when did you first become aware of exosomes?
So I've had the honor of having 25% of my practice be dedicated to research for over 30 years, beginning first with injectable fibroblast therapy, then using stem cells from our own body. I was introduced to exosomes well over 3 years ago now. They are such tremendous cargo packages, really full of proteins, growth factors, messenger and microRNA, that we've seen be a real game changer in the field of aesthetic and reconstructive surgery.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. I think maybe almost 2 years is the availability, and adoption maybe less than a year for most people.
Yes.
So it's a very cutting edge thing. And yet, because you're so research-focused throughout your career, you're able to pivot and incorporate. So tell us some of the interesting things. I mean, the lecture, the slides, the things that you showed, quite remarkable in terms of preventing and treating certain very common skin conditions, hypertrophic scars, stria or stretch marks, but also in the people who were just getting the weekend facials or the laser or radio frequency. How can exosomes theoretically and practically boost the results that all people doing these procedures are getting?
The effects of exosomes on the skin, particularly being able to stimulate fibroblast migration to enhance neocollagenesis, the formation of new collagen. Exosomes' ability to improve vascularity through angiogenesis. Exosomes' ability to aid in the homing of an injury or a wound. So we have been undergoing a study looking at various applications of exosomes, both in the aesthetic realm, non-surgically, surgically, but then looking at our reconstructive cases with many cutaneous cancers. In our wound healing, we have a foundation for survivors of violence where we donate our surgery to survivors of violence. And so we've amassed thousands of scar patients over the years and learned a lot about multimodality scar therapy. So within, first of all, exosome's ability also to be extremely have an anti-inflammatory effect, and I think really a very underrated anti-prostaglandin effect or pain modulating effect. Many of our surgical patients didn't take any of their pain medications afterwards. They were astounded at how good they felt when we pre-treated surgical beds such as facelift beds, rhinoplasty beds, our breast augmentation and abdominoplasty patients prior to and during surgery and then afterwards. When we look at the topical applications of exosomes, one of the most gratifying patient populations have been the acne patients. Recent studies have shown that the inflammatory stage of acne precedes the comedone stage. So anything we can do to reduce the inflammatory milieu for an acne patient goes a long way at reducing acne. So doing combination therapies of needle radio frequency and then the topical application of exosomes, as well as intradermal injection of exosomes, showed a great reduction in acne. That same combination also just in the general aging population for aging skin, we saw improvements in the tone, the quality of skin, the color, the clarity of skin, which leads into two other big areas, melasma and unwanted vascular conditions such as rosacea, the inflammatory components in those aspects, exosomes played a big role in. I've already mentioned again our surgical population. By pre-injecting a potential incision area, we see an improvement in scars. We're really trying to work towards scarless surgery, and I think in our lifetime we'll be able to see that. Again, anything that can improve the quality of the result for the patient with what's left over from a scar standpoint.
Yeah, I mean, I think everyone always loves showing their best before and after cases, but I think even for a sort of cynical and seasoned audience, a lot of those things were quite impressive. And I would venture a guess that if you put the most experienced plastic surgeons in a room, there'd be a lot of eye rolling and a lot of questions.
Okay, everyone, we've been alpha and beta test sites for many companies over the years, many laser companies, light-based companies, cosmetic and drug companies. And I'm really not a believer in anything until my patients show me the endpoints.
Right.
And I think at the end of the day, that's really what you and I want and our patients want, and that's what they're paying for, and that's results.
Yeah.
Because even though it's inherent for us to want to please our patients, they're still walking examples of what we do.
Yeah. I thought you brought up a great point about the body dysmorphia, because those are the people who tend to utilize aesthetic services. But I just found it astounding when you did the keloid reoperations. I mean, obviously there's a systemic effect of exosomes, but I mean, it was just unequivocal, the half that you treated with exosomes versus the one that you didn't. I mean, that was just shocking.
The combination, particularly with keloids, of excising the keloid with a carbon dioxide laser, which we know already decreases the recurrence, and then applying exosomes at the time and afterwards, again, has an anti-inflammatory effect, a pro-collagen effect. So we're looking, not everyone has a CO2 laser, so now we're, a branch of the study now is excising the keloid with a scalpel alone, which by itself has a near 100% recurrence rate, and injecting keloids with injecting the exosomes with the same protocols that we did with the CO2 to see if the exosomes alone can make a difference.
I mean, it's just amazing, really. Yes. Yeah, well, I really appreciate your depth of field in terms of the basic science, the clinical, even the philanthropic aspects of what you're doing in terms of really trying to help the patient. I think that
comes from our Canadian upbringing in many ways. Our patients really matter the most and give us the most joy when we see success.
Well, I didn't know. That's probably why I was born there, because there was some problem in Saskatchewan and there were job openings for my dad when he got kicked out of this country. Yes. He had to go to Saskatchewan, so I need to know the backstory at some point about you, because you teased me. You said that Medicare was born in Saskatchewan.
In Saskatchewan in 1966.
What's the backstory, just in a nutshell?
In 1966, doctors went out on strike, complaining about the nationalization of healthcare, and really Medicare came thereafter. And I think we are in the United States today where we were in Canada in the 70s and 80s with healthcare, and I don't think it's going to get much better.
Small world. Well, I think my dad was already a family doc in Saskatoon in 64, because I know my brother was born there in 65, so I wonder if he was a striker or a scab, or I'll have to ask my mom. Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Chernoff. We really appreciate it.